بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي أبدع الأفلاك والأرضين، والصلاة على من كان نبيا وآدم بين الماء والطين، وعلى آله وأصحابه وأهل بيته أجمعين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ثاني اثنين إذ هما في الغار. صدق الله مولانا العظيم. ببركته إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي. يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وصل عليه. الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله، وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا حبيب الله. الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله، وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا رحمة للعالمين. One more time, please. زبان خاموش نہ رہے. الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله، وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا خاتم النبيين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. After praising Allah Almighty and sending infinite salutations and blessings upon Sayyidul Anbiya wal Mursaleen, Sultani Medina Noor Sina Ahmad Mustafa wal Mujtaba Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we shall begin. After the messengers and the prophets of Allah Almighty, after the Anbiya and the Mursaleen, many great individuals have walked the face of this earth. Many great individuals. And I want you to listen as I go through the list of great individuals who have walked on the face of this earth. When it came to the field of wilayat, of the tasawwuf and spirituality, then there is none greater than the great Sultan al-Awliya Piran-e-Pir, Shamshai Baghdad bi Sayyid Abdul Qadir Al Jilani Hassani wal Husayni radiyallahu anhu. In the fields of wilayat, you have the great Khwaja-e-Khwajagan Sultan al Hind Ata'un Nabi Naib-e Rasul Khwaja Sayyid Mu'inuddin Hassan Ajmeri Sanjari Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayhi. Again, in the fields of wilayat, in the fields of tasawwuf and spirituality, you have great individuals like the great Mahbub-e-Ilahi, Sultanul Awliya, Khwaja Sayyid Nizamuddin Awliya, Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayhi. And you have the great Imam-e-Rabbani, Mujaddid Al-Fisani, Imam Sheikh Ahmad Farooqi As-Sirhindi, Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayhi. In the field of ulama, scholars, true scholars, individuals who are worthy to be called scholars, you have the great Imam Fakhruddin Razi, Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayhi. You have the great Hujjatul Islam, Abu Hamid Al-Ghazali, Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayh. Names that we should all know and we should all have an interest in as well. And as I'm going through these names, yet I assume that Imam Sahib is just taking our time. Imam Shafi'i, Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayh, they said, Inna dhikri saliheena tanzilur rahmah. Now with the remembrance of the pious individuals, Allah Almighty's mercy begins to descend upon them. Great individuals, great scholars who have served this deen, like the great Imam Jalaluddin As-Suyuti, Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayh. That great Imam Jalaluddin As-Suyuti, who was blessed with the vision of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam over 70 times in a wakeful state. Imam Suyuti Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayh, an encyclopedic scholar, an individual who wrote 737 books.
Imam Suyuti rahmatullahi ta'ala. Then you have other great scholars like Sayyidi Ala Hazrat, Imam Ahl Sunnat, Imam Ahmad Riza Khan alayhi rahmatullahi. Mullah Ali Qari rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. Great ulama, great scholars of this deen. Imam Hajar, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. Imam Badruddin Ayni rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. Imam Ibn Hajar al-Haythami rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. Ulama and scholars. Who are we in comparison to these great individuals? In the fields of wilayat, you have them great men. In the fields of scholars and ulama, you have these great individuals. And then you have in the field of hadith, muhaddithun, great scholars, like the great Muhammad bin Ismail al-Bukhari radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. An individual who was born blind, but through the du'as of his mother, Mother's Day, Mother's Day. Imam Bukhari was that individual who was born Nabina. Aaj log kehne Bukhari. But we don't know what Imam Bukhari's life was about. Imam Bukhari was born blind. And then it was through the du'as of his mother that he regained his sight. Such is the quwwat and the power that Allah Almighty has placed in the du'a, in the prayer and the supplication of a mother, that a child who is born blind regains his sight. The great Muhammad bin Ismail al-Bukhari rahmatullahi ta'ala. Then you have his great student, the great Imam Muslim radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. The great Muhammad bin Isa al-Tirmizi rahmatullahi ta'ala. Imam Abu Dawood, Imam Nasa'i, Imam Ibn Majah. Great muhaddithun, great men of Allah Almighty who have walked the face of this earth. And they've all come after the time of the Anbiya and the Mursaleen. They have all come after the times of the prophets and the messengers. May Allah Almighty be pleased with them all. Then you have the feet of Imamat. Allahu Akbar. Great individuals. In particular, the four great Imams. Imam Nu'man bin Thabit Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi ta'ala. That great man of Allah Almighty. People say that he's just an Imam. He's just an individual who compiled Sharia, the founder of the Hanafi Madhab. Imam Abu Hanifa was not just a great alim of the deen, but he was a great Sufi and arif billah as well. He was that man of Allah Almighty, that every night for 40 years, he would pray 500 units of nawaf. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi ta'ala. And they said that for 40 years, he prayed Salatul Fajr with the same ablution that he had at the time of Salatul Isha. Great man of Allah Almighty, the great Muhammad bin Idris al-Shafi rahmatullahi ta'ala. The great Faqih al-Madinah, the great Malik bin Anas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Personally, my greatest and most favorite scholar out of all of the scholars of Islam, Imam Malik bin Anas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. His adab, his ishq, his muhabbat, his love, his honor and respect for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, everybody knows. Like in the siddha of this love and respect, this level of veneration and honor for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Malik was that individual. He would never walk through the center of Medina to Munawwara. He would always walk on the outskirts. Those of us who are going, inshallah, in a week or two, we need to learn the etiquettes of walking through the city of Medina to Munawwara. He would never ride an animal in Medina to Munawwara, Imam Malik rahmatullahi ta'ala. He would never relieve or urinate in the city of Medina to Munawwara. He would always go to the outskirts of Medina to Munawwara. And what is the siddha of all of this? What is the result of all of this level of love and respect that he had? Imam Zahabi mentions in his Sirul A'lam ibn Nubala. Imam Ibn Jawzi does nakal of this as well. That Imam Malik bin Anas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he was from amongst those ulama that every single night he had didar Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Every single night he was blessed with the vision of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Great ulama. Sheikh Abdul Haq Muhaddis Dehlvi rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. Sheikh Shah Waliullah Muhaddis Dehlvi rahmatullahi alayhi. Sheikh Abdul Aziz, his son, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. Great ulama. Then you have the great Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, that great man of Allah Almighty, that he saw Allah himself over 500 times in his dream. Imam Zahabi is the mecca of this in his Sunnah A'lam in Nubala. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, who knew over 1 million ahadith by heart. These are ulama and scholars. These are the true inheritors of the deen of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He knew over 1 million ahadith by heart. And not like we do, we have to bring the books with us. He knew the mutun of these hadith by heart. He knew the asnad of these hadith by heart. He knew the text by heart. He knew the chain by heart. And he was that great man of Allah Almighty. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. That when he left this dunya, 1 million people came and read janazah over him. They said this was the greatest and the biggest funeral prayer in the history and the tariq of Islam. And my wijdan, my own personal opinion is this, that for every ahadith that he knew by heart, for every narration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he knew by heart, in place of that narration, Allah Almighty sent a person to read Salatul Janazah. 1 million ahadith by heart he knew. 1 million people came and read janazah over him. Allahu Akbar. Great ulama, great scholars who have walked the face of this earth. How many of us know about these great men of Allah Almighty? How many of our youngsters have heard these names before? Yes, we know about the pop stars and the movie stars and the celebrities. But these great individuals, men and women, who gave their life for the sake of Allah and His Rasul, very few of our youngsters know about these people. And then you have to go back a generation before that, the generation of the Tabi'un, great individuals and great men of Allah Almighty. The people like Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who were the direct teacher of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi ta'ala, who were the direct teacher of Imam Malik bin Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who were the dada ustad of Imam Shafi'i and Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, Imam from the Ahlul Bayt, then the great Tabi'un, Khwaja Awaisi Kanni radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Sayyidina Sa'id ibn Musayyab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the great Sayyidina Khwaja Hasan al-Basri radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And then you have to go the generation before. The generation before the generation of the Tabi'in. Then you have the generation of the Sahaba. You have the generation of the companions. And each and every Sahabi had his rank and his maqam and martaba. They had their status. They had their rank and honor. So much so that the ulama have mentioned that the lowest rank Sahabi is greater than all of the Khwajas, the Qutub, the Abdals, and the Ghosis of the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Such is the rank of a Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That individual who with his eyes saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Who saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Who read the kalima, accepted Islam and then died upon this iman. That person is a Sahabi. Then from amongst the Sahaba you have a categorization as well. We are talking about great men who have walked the face of this earth after the prophets and the messengers. From amongst the Sahaba you have the Ashab al-Badr, 313 Sahaba. 313 Sahaba. And that's it. Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they are forming the rows in the Battle of Badr. Sirat ibn Hisham, Qutb al-Sirah as well, other books of Sirah as well. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is forming the rows of the Sahaba. 313 are about to face an army of 1,000. They are forming the rows. The Sahaba are making noise. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the Sahaba, be quiet, do the dhikr of Allah Almighty. And as Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is forming the rows, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam take the stick and they poke the stomach of Sayyidina Sawad al-Ansari radiallahu ta'ala. Just to give you a glimpse of the rank of the Ashab al-Badr. Sayyidina Sawad al-Ansari radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He is poked in his stomach by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. At that point, Sayyidina Sawad al-Ansari said, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, you have helped. You have helped me. And I want recompense, I want badala. Sahaba who were standing straight in the row, all of them looked at Sayyidina Sawad al-Ansari. Sawad, is everything okay with you? We are about to face the enemy and you want badala, you want recompense from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Sawad was adamant. Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, you have helped me. I want revenge. I want compensation. Rahmatul lil alameen, Shafi'ul Muznibeen. At that point, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam took the blessed Tamiz Mubarak, lifted it and said, Sawab, take your recompense. Sawab, take your badada. When Sayyidina Sawad saw the blessed flesh of the stomach of Rasulullah, Sawad al-Ansari ran towards Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Sayyidina Sawad ran towards Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and he began to kiss the stomach of Rasulullah Ashab al-Badr, their rank, their daraja, their status, their honor. Sayyidina Sawad began to kiss the blessed stomach of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Now the rest of the Sahaba were shocked. What is Sawad doing? First he was Badra, now he's kissing the stomach of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. At that point, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam didn't say to Sawad, this is shirk. Sawad, this is bid'ah, what you're doing is wrong. You can't kiss my stomach. At that point, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Sawad, tell me, why is it that you are kissing my stomach? Sayyidina Sawad said, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habiballah, I face imminent death. That maut is in front of me. And before I die, I want my lips to touch your blessed stomach, Ya Rasulullah. This is the reason why I'm kissing you, Ya Rasulullah. And I know that if I kiss your stomach, Ya Rasulullah, Jahannam will become haram upon me. Aqeedah of the Sahaba. Aqeedah of the Sahaba, which we have neglected and which we have forsaken today in the 21st century. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam at that point then took his blessed hands and did dua for Sayyidina Sawad al-Ansari. That Allah make Jahannam haram upon Sayyidina Sawad. And in that very battle, Sayyidina Sawad al-Ansari became a martyr, a shaheed of the deen. Ashab al-Badr have their rank and status. Then from amongst the Ashab al-Badr, you have the Ashar al-Bashara. Those 10 great individuals who were given the glad tidings of Jannatul Firdaus in this dunya. Ajkal lo kehte hain maazallah, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam can't do nafa for anybody. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam can't benefit anybody. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, ma'azallah, didn't even know what was behind the wall. Arey, we said, forget what Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, or you're trying to say that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam didn't know. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam knew so much that he was given the grand tidings of Jannatul Firdaus in this dunya. That's how much Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam knew, that he was given the grand tidings of Jannat in this dunya. The Talha bin Ubaidillah, Jannah. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, Jannah. Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, Jannah. Zubair ibn al-Awwam, Jannah. Sa'd ibn, or Sa'id ibn Zayd, Jannah. And then from the Ashra al-Bashra, you have four very great individuals. Allah. Special individuals, noble individuals, known as the Khulafa al-Rashidin. The four rightly guided caliphs. You have Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, Sayyidina Ali Murtaza radiyallahu ta'ala. Then you have Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan radiyallahu ta'ala. Dhul Nurayn. Then you have Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab al-Faruq radiyallahu ta'ala. Then from amongst these four, there was the greatest of them all. From amongst these four, there was the greatest of them all. And from the fields of Vilayat, from the fields of Hadith, from the fields of Ulama, from the Tabi'een, from the Taba Tabi'een, from all these peoples whose names we have just listened to, the greatest of them all is Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. The greatest of them all. Afdalul Bashar ba'd al-Anbiya bil ijma. The greatest human being after the prophets and the messengers by consensus is Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. He is the greatest. There's no denying that. But the question is, and we all know this, we all know that he's the greatest. But the question is, why is he the greatest? Why is he the greatest? And after reading for the last 2-3 days, and it's very difficult to read and drive at the same time, I wouldn't recommend it. I came back from London at 3:30 last night, woke up for Fajr, had to go to class at 9 o'clock in the morning, then come back to drive to Bradford, then you're preparing the speech, then Batley. So don't read and drive at the same time. Lekin after reading for the last 2-3 days, and may the Narkis insan, my knowledge is nothing. My intellect is nothing. My opinion means nothing. Lekin I've come to the conclusion that there are three reasons as to why Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is the greatest after all of the prophets and the messengers. Three reasons. Number one, that when it came to companionship, there was nobody greater than Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. When it came to rafaqat, companionship, nobody was greater than Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Number one. Number two, when it came to love, ishq and muhabbat, nobody was greater than Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Dusra reason. Or third reason, when it came to sacrifice, qurbani, there was nobody greater than Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Three reasons. And when we make a dawah, we have to give the lie as well. There's a qaida in ilm al-manazir. Da'wa bila dalilin ghayru masmuh. That a claim without any evidences is not listened to. Aaj ka log bade dawa karne, milad is bid'ah, yaad mishrif is shirk. That is their claim. It is upon them who are making the claim to provide the evidences. Ye qaida in ilm al-manazir, in the science of debate. We've just now made a claim. Claim is what? That the greatest human being, after all of the prophets, after all of the messengers, is who? Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala. And to support this claim, he presented three dalail. Number one, why is he the greatest? Because of companionship. Number two, why is he the greatest? Because of love. And number three, why is he the greatest? Because of sacrifice. And in light of these three points which I've just mentioned, we will provide our evidences. But before that, let's just get a little bit of a background information regarding Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Sabak sikhna. The problem is that we listen to these things but we forget. We have to be constantly reminded year upon year. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. They were born 2 years and a few months after the year of the elephant. When Abraha came from Yemen and he came with the intention to destroy the Kaaba, Allah Almighty then sent the birds with small pebbles and stones, threw them at the elephant. We all know all this. Alam tara kayfa fa'ala rabbuka bi ashabil fil. We know all of this. 2 years and a few months after this incident, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is born. And they are 2 years and a few months the junior of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Younger than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His father, his name was Uthman ibn Amir, also known as Abu Quhafa. Abu, you have to work with me now. It's good, you repeat these things. His name was Uthman bin Amir, Abu Quhafa. And his mother's name was Salma bint Sahab. Also known as Ummul Khair. Also known as Ummul Khair. His own name was Abdullah. Imam Nawawi mentions this. Imam Suyuti has the nakal of this in his Tariq al-Khulafa. His own name was Abdullah, the servant of Allah Almighty. And he was commonly known by his nickname Atiq. Atiq, which means free. The one who has been free. And there are two narrations mentioned out of the many which I could have chosen. In Tariq al-Khulafa, Imam Jalaluddin as-Suyuti rahmatullahi ta'ala mentioned. But why was he known as Atiq? Ibn Asakir was nakal of this. Narrated by Musa ibn Talha, that he said that I asked my father Talha. That why was Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu called Atiq? At that point, he said that his mother had no sons which survived. And when she gave birth to him, gave birth to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, she faced towards the Kaaba, the house of Allah Almighty, and she made a dua. That, oh Allah, if this one is atiq, if this one is free from death, then give him to me. Dua of a mother. Ummul Khair, meaning mother of goodness. She made this dua that, oh Allah, if you free him from death and you give him to me, then I in return will give him in your faith. I in return will give him in your path. This is one reason as to why he was called Haqiq. The other reason is because what Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that whoever is pleased to look upon a face or upon an individual who is free from the fires of Jahannam, then let them look at Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Let them look at Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala. That he is freed, atiq, from the fires of Jahannam. Then if you want to look at somebody who is free from Jahannam, from the fires of hell, then look at Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala. So his name, Abdullah. Then his nickname, Atiq. He famously is known as Abu Bakr. Ulama dispute over why he was known as Abu Bakr. He didn't have any son. Abu is father, Bakr is obviously a name. He didn't have any sons by the name of Bakr. This is a name, a laqab which was given to him. And then he had the other title which was As-Siddiq. Abu Bakr As-Siddiq. And why he was called As-Siddiq, inshallah, we will. Then he had his youth amongst the people of Makkah al-Mukarramah. He lived in Makkah, he was born in Makkah, he traded in Makkah. He was somebody who was highly successful, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Highly successful. And as a youth, he would go on trade caravans to Yemen and Damascus. The people in Makkah al-Mukarramah in that time, they were professionals or experts in the fields of trade. Caravans, they would take to Yemen, Syria, so on and so forth. And from a young age, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq used to go on these trade caravans. He used to go on these expeditions. And he went so many times that this then eventually became his business. And he was an individual who became extremely successful at his business. And because of his business, he became extremely wealthy as well. He became extremely wealthy as well. But he wasn't only just recognized for his skill in business. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq wasn't somebody who was just recognized for his skill in business. But he was an individual who had unique manners and conduct as well. This is before Islam. This is before Alan and Abu Bakr. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was known for his honesty and his truthfulness. People would trust him. And he was a leader amongst the people of the Quraysh, amongst the chiefs of the Quraysh. He was somebody who led them. And also, often people would seek his advice. They would seek his counsel. He was somebody who was respected in society. And he had a reputation of being honest. And he would constantly protect the rights of other people. And he didn't indulge in the environment of ignorance which was prevalent in Makkah al-Mukarramah at the time. People were openly drinking alcohol. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq never ever drank alcohol. People were openly worshipping idols, doing shirk, prostrating to idols made out of stone and wood. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq never ever prostrated to an idol. He never committed shirk. People were openly committing adultery, sleeping with women. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq never ever committed adultery. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq lived such a life before Islam that nobody could find a single fault in him. Nobody could find a blemish in him. Nobody could criticize him for any inappropriate behavior. And then from a young age, he became associated and connected with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He became a close friend of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He became a companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was so close to Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, his own mother said, it is as if they are twin brothers. That's how close they are. It's as if they are like twin brothers. And this connection, this companionship, this relationship, this friendship became even closer when Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam married mother of the believer Sayyida Khadija al-Kubra radiyallahu ta'ala. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is 25 years old. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is roughly 23 years old. Their relationship becomes even more intimate and close. Why? Because Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam moves into the house of Sayyida Khadija radiyallahu ta'ala. And the house of Sayyidina Khadija is next door to the house of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. So from the age of 23, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq becomes the neighbor of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was a very close friend of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. People would see them together all the time. And Makkah Sharif was a very small place. Not like it is today, but they're expanding it. Jeopardizing our history and our tarikh. Destroying relics. In those days, Makkah Sharif was very closely knit. Everybody knew everybody. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq knew Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And everybody else knew that these two were very close friends. Eventually the time came. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did Alan and Abu Bakr. They announced their prophethood. They are 40 years old. And the first man to accept Islam is Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. The first man to accept Islam is Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And they said that the first person to read and perform the prayer with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had such an influence on Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq that as soon as Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam announced his prophethood, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was the first man to accept Islam. And this tells you and me a very important lesson. That if we want our closest to change, if we want our family members to change, then we have to demonstrate good character as well. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq accepted Islam because he had first-hand experience regarding the character and the conduct of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He knew the character of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He knew the mannerisms and the ethics of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He knew that Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was al-Amin and al-Sadiq, truthful and trustworthy. He knew that Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam never lied. He knew that Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was kind to the poor. He knew that Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam would honor his neighbors. When he himself had seen this firsthand, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq did not hesitate when Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that I am the Prophet of Allah. He accepted Islam. And this companionship, which started before Islam, went from strength to strength after Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam announced prophethood. After Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam announced prophethood. And there's one particular story, one particular narration. Like I said, it's impossible to go through the full life. This is just a brief overview. As Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is suffering, so too were the Sahaba as well. Sayyidina Bilal was suffering. Everybody knows the story. Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they are on the sand, the desert of Makkah al-Mukarramah, scorching midday sun over his head. Umayyah bin Khalaf, his master, he said, leave the religion of Islam. Sayyidina Bilal said, Ahad, Allah is one. As Sayyidina Bilal is being tortured and he's suffering, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq are walking past. This is one example of how the Sahaba was suffering. Look how easy we have it today. As Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is walking past, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is also walking past as well. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says to Bilal, that Bilal, don't worry, be patient. And they look towards Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. They don't say anything. Isharai kafiya. They look towards Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq realized what it is that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam wanted. So he went home, he took all of the wealth that he had. He gathered it and he brought it to Umayyah bin Khalaf. And he said to Umayyah bin Khalaf, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq said, Umayyah bin Khalaf, that Umayyah bin Khalaf, I want to buy the freedom of Bilal. Name your price. At that point, Umayyah bin Khalaf, the master of Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu ta'ala, that Bilal who became the Mu'azzin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Bilal who stood on top of the Kaaba, Allah, I said, okay, I told you I'm not much of a speaker, most of you are falling asleep. Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu ta'ala, you know when they stood, Fateh Makkah, on top of the Kaaba, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam were doing tawaf around the Kaaba. Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu ta'ala is doing the azan. Sayyidina Bilal doesn't know what to do. Whether to stand in one place and do the azan or whether to follow Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and do the azan. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is doing tawaf. Sayyidina Bilal doesn't know what to do.
So Sayyidina Bilal begins to follow Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. As Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam are going around the Kaaba, so too does Bilal begin to go around the top of the Kaaba as well. Wherever Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was going, that's where Sayyidina Bilal was going as well. This Bilal, Umayyah bin Khalaf, name your price. He told them, Abu Bakr, give me all that you have. All the wealth that you have. They saw that the wealth that Abu Bakr bought with him. So, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq didn't hesitate. They gave the wealth that they had. And they bought the freedom of Sayyidina Bilal. Later, Umayyah bin Khalaf goes that, Abu Bakr, if you had given me half of what you had paid me, I would have freed Bilal. At that point, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq said that, if you had asked for all of the riches in the world, I would have prayed it for the freedom of Bilal. I would have prayed it for the freedom of Bilal. That's how much Bilal's freedom means to Islam. That's how much Bilal's freedom means to Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Muslims suffered in early Islam. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq was no exception to this. And on one particular occasion, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq, and at this point only about 40 people have accepted Islam. Only 40 people or so. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. They said to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, let us go and openly and publicly proclaim Islam. Let us go openly and publicly invite people towards Islam. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam didn't want to upset Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq. So he said, okay Abu Bakr, if you want to do this, then I will come with you and everybody else who has accepted Islam, they will come as well. You stand in front of the Kaaba, Abu Bakr, you stand in front of the Kaaba and you call and invite people towards Islam. And we will stand there and we will support you. So Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq became the first orator, the first public speaker in Islam. He stood outside the Kaaba, the doors of the Kaaba, and he openly began to invite people towards Islam. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq began to recite the melodious verses of the Quran. When the chiefs of the Quraysh, the Kuffar of Makkah al-Mukarramah, when they heard this, when they became aware of this, they began to beat Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq was a respected man. He had reputation in Makkah al-Mukarramah. He had honor and rank in Makkah al-Mukarramah. As I mentioned earlier, he was from amongst the chiefs of Makkah al-Mukarramah. But because now he has abandoned the Quraysh and he has chosen Allah and his Rasul, the Quraysh had to do something. So they began to beat Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala. And they beat Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq so much. And in particular, there was one individual, Utbah ibn Rabiya. He was responsible for beating Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu so much. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq fell unconscious. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq, Afdalul Bashar ba'dal Anbiya, he fell unconscious. Amen. He fell unconscious. All of his relatives and his family, they came towards the Kaaba and they took Sayyidina Abu Bakr back to his house. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu for several days was unconscious. For several days. When he regained consciousness, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the first thing that he said was that is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam okay? His family was shocked. He had just been beaten to a pulp. From head to toe he was bleeding. Unconscious for several days. Barely can move. Bruises on his face. And all he is worried about is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Shocked they were. This is an example of the companionship. The friendship between Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He wouldn't eat. He wouldn't drink anything. He just kept asking, how is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? How is Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam? Tell me, how is my beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? At that point, they realized that they had to go to Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam. And they had to ask Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam, that Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, my son, and who went? Umar Khair went. Mother went. She said that my son, he won't eat anything, he won't drink anything until he knows that you are okay, Ya Rasulullah. At that point, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, good, tell Abu Bakr, I'm okay, I'm fine, everything's okay. At that point, when Umar Khair came back and told Sayyidina Abu Bakr, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, Sayyidina Abu Bakr goes, I'm not convinced. I want to see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm not convinced. I don't want to just know that he's okay. I want to see that he's okay. Barely walking. Unconscious for several days. So his family waited until night time. When everybody was asleep. And they took him from the house all the way to the house of Arkam bin Arkam radiyallahu ta'ala. Near the mountain of Safa. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was there. They knocked on the door. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself opens the door. And when Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala who sees Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he jumps and he begins to kiss Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He begins to kiss Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the face. This is love. This is companionship. And at that point Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Abu Bakr, why are you worrying? Why are you upset? Because Ya Rasulallah, Ya Habibullah, your safety means everything. If you are safe, I am okay. If you are happy, I am okay. As long as you are happy, Ya Rasulallah, as long as you are safe, Ya Rasulallah, then I am okay. At that point, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Abu Bakr, don't worry, I am fine. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq began to cry. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, though this was a moment of happiness for him, looked towards his mother. Umar Khair hadn't accepted Islam. He looked towards his mother, and then he looked towards Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, I ask and beg of you only one thing, that raise your hands and make dua for my mother, that she accepts Islam. She accepts Islam. At that point, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam raises his hands. They make dua. And as soon as they finished their dua, Umar Khair said, Ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, even though this was a moment of happiness for himself, he wanted everybody else to be happy as well. He wanted his mother to accept Islam as well. And this companionship between Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it reached its peak when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated from Makkah to Mukarramah to Medina. They were next door to one another. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq or Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regularly visit Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq day and night. This is what friends do. This is what intimate friends do. Such close companionship. Such a relationship. Such intimacy. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam day and night would go to Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq's house. And this is Sayyidul Anbiya'i wal Mursaleen. This is Sayyidul Kawnain, the leader and master of both worlds. But he is going to the house of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. The time eventually came. Allah Almighty gives the order of the hookah for the Muslims to migrate from Makkah Sharif to Madinatul Munawwara. And turn by turn, groups by groups, the Sahaba are migrating towards Madinatul Munawwara. One day, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq comes to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq says, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, give me permission and let me migrate to Madinatul Munawwara. Let me also leave Makkah Sharif and migrate to Medina. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that point said, Abu Bakr, be patient. Maybe a friend will come and accompany you. Maybe a friend will come and accompany you. When Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq heard this, they began to smile. He realized what Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was saying. He realized that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was saying that he was going to accompany Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq began to make provisions. He began to make plans for the migration. He bought the two camels and eventually he told Asma, his daughter, that you will be the one who will come and give us food. And he told his son as well, make the plans. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is coming. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is migrating. And then the day actually came. Allah Almighty orders Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to migrate from Makkah to Makkah to Medina to Munawwara. And when the day came, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knocks on the door of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And it's midday. And this was an unusual time in that society, in Makkah al-Mukarramah. It was an unusual time for people to go into other people's houses. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq opens the door. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, who's at home? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, who's at home? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq says, don't worry, Ya Rasulullah. Don't worry, Ya Habibullah. It is only my daughters who are at home. At that point, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Huzur Ziyad Ummat rahmatullahi ta'ala, they mentioned this in their Ziyad al-Nabi Sharif. At that point,
Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says to Sayyidina Abu Bakr, that Abu Bakr, the order has been given from Allah Almighty. Allah Almighty has ordered us to migrate. At that point, Sayyidina Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, she says that my father, he began to cry. And she goes, I've never seen somebody cry out of happiness as I saw my father cry on that particular day. He was so happy that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that Abu Bakr, you will accompany me on this journey. You will be my companion, you will be my refuge. This is the peak of companionship. And this was one reason why Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is the greatest human being after all of the prophets and the messengers. Then the actual time came. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they accompany Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They're leaving Makkah al-Mukarramah. And they're going towards Ghare Thawb. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is in front of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Then Abu Bakr as-Siddiq moves to the right of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Then Abu Bakr as-Siddiq moves to the left of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Then Abu Bakr as-Siddiq behind Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Ya Abu Bakr, what's wrong? You move to the front, you move to the right, you move to the left, then behind me. Why are you doing this? Said Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. They said, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, whenever I fear that the enemy will attack from front, then I go and stand in front of you. When I fear that the enemy will attack from the right, then I stand on your right, Ya Rasulullah. When I fear that the enemy will attack you from the left, I stand on your left, Ya Rasulullah. And when I fear that the enemy will attack you from behind, Ya Rasulullah, I stand behind you to protect you and one in you. The human shield of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then the actual time came for Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq to climb Ghare Thawb. And this isn't two youngsters climbing Ghare Thawb. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is 51. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are 53 years old. They are not young. They are not in their youth or their prime. Today when we go to Makkah al-Mukarramah, if we are going to climb Ghare Thawb, it takes us a long time. We wait for the sun to be right at the bottom, just after sunrise. Then we want to climb it. Because we know that the pressure is on us. We can't do it. So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq went young. 53 and 51. At that point Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq makes a gesture. He makes an offer. He says, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, allow me to carry you on my back. Those of you who been to Ghare Thawb, allow me to carry you, Ya Rasulullah, on my back. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. He himself is 51. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is 53. Ya Rasulullah, give me the honor, the rank, the status of carrying you on my back. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Abu Bakr, if this is what you want, then I will allow you. I will allow you to carry me on your back. And he wasn't just carrying a normal human being. He was carrying Sultan al-Madina Nure Sina. He was carrying Sultan al-Anbiya wal-Mursaleen, Sayyid al-Anbiya wal-Mursaleen, Ahmad al-Mustafa al-Mustafa, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why did Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam allow Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq to carry him? Why? Ulama mentioned, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was allowed this honor and this privilege because Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam wanted to see whether Abu Bakr as-Siddiq could cope with the burden of the Ummah after Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did this. Who became the first Khalifa? It was Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And this was one incident to show and highlight that Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was ready for the Khilafat and to become Khalifatul Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then they eventually get to the cave. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq says, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, you wait here. Allow me, give me permission, ijazah to go inside so that I can clean out this cave. I can make sure that every hole is filled. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Abu Bakr, that's fine, go inside, see if it's clean. And then they start to take off their garments and they start to plug the holes in the cave. Such love, such companionship, cleaning the cave. At that point, they said to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, it's safe to enter. Safe to enter into the cave. And there was only one hole left. Run out of garment, one hole left. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq used their blessed heel on their foot and they covered this hole. And they said, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, enter now. You must be tired. Rest, Ya Rasulullah. Who was carrying who on the back? Abu Bakr was carrying Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. But now Sayyidina Abu Bakr is saying, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, you must be tired. You rest. This is the level of love between Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Afdalul Bashar ba'da al-Anbiya. You rest, Ya Rasulullah. Then we know that a scorpion came, bit Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq on the ear. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was going through extortionate pain, extreme torment. And the tears were beginning to flow from the eyes of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. One of these tears fell on the cheek of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi sallallahu awoke from their sleep and they said, Ya Abu Bakr, is everything okay? Why are you crying? Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq said, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, a scorpion has bit me. Hey? Scorpion has bit me. Some riwayat say a snake. A scorpion has bitten me, Ya Rasulullah. At that point, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq didn't say, No worry, Ya Rasulullah. I'll call 911. I'll call accident and emergency. You have no means of giving me shafa'at, Ya Rasulullah. No means of giving me shifa'at, Ya Rasulullah. Abu Bakr's aqidah was what? That if I told Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that I'm in pain, then Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was the one who was going to cure. At that point, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam take their blessed saliva, they place it on the heel of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq's pain is removed. Eventually, how long did they stay in the gharis? 3 days and three nights. 3 days and three nights. And they say, there's a riwayat here, there's a narration here, mentioned that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that I have transferred all that I have in my heart to Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq. I have transferred all that I have in my heart to Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. Such was this intimacy for 3 days and three nights. And I'm not going to go into the whole discussion of Surah Tawbah, verse number 40, where Allah Almighty says that there was two of them, and the third was Allah Almighty, that whole discussion. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq then becomes anxious. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, Don't worry, inna Allaha ma'ana. Indeed Allah Almighty is with us. We know all of this. Just touch upon that narration. The Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that I have transferred all that I have to Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Such was the transfer that eventually they get to Madinatul Munawwara. Eventually they get to Madinatul Munawwara. And the Ansari, the people of Medina, they don't know who is Abu Bakr and they don't know who is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Such was the nur which was transferred from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And at that point Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq had to take a cloth and had to put it over the head of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said that this is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is Rasulullah sallallahu. They have to make that distinction. But such was the nur which was transferred from chest to chest from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radhiyallahu anhu. Companionship. And then he was that very same Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Then when the Battle of Badr came, he was the one who would stand outside the tent of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The bravery of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Battle of Badr came second year after Hijrah. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is 53 years old. Unfortunately, these Babi mashallah who are sitting here, when you get to 40, never mind 50, how old it is, how difficult it is to do anything. All the energy is taken out of you. All that passion and commitment that you have in your jawani, that is gone. But Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq had so much passion, so much energy, that the source of this energy was his love for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That was the source of his energy. He would be in the shelter in the Battle of Badr, in the tent of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would stand outside, he would have his sword ready, defending Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was present at Badr, he was present at Uhud, he was present at Khaybar, at Khandaq, all of the battles. And he gave so much to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When you have this intimate relationship with somebody, you love that person. You begin to love that person. And when you love somebody, you're willing to give anything for that person. This is why Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, nobody's wealth, nobody's property benefited me more
than the wealth and the property of Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq.
Nobody's wealth and property. And I'm going to end on this narration. I don't think I've been justice today. Imam Asim is very well trained in these things. He can go on for days. He'll travel from one place to another place. Maybe the bus will turn here. I do 3 days in London, I'll be shut here. Sunday is usually my rest day. I always say this in my speeches. I don't bring much passion and commitment that I normally have. I'm extremely tired. My body isn't used to it as he is. Later I'm going to end with one narration. Maybe you've heard this narration before, maybe you haven't. Inshallah Azza wa Jal. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala. End with this narration. Namaz ka time wait. This is mentioned in the Sunan of Imam Tirmizi. Imam Abu Dawud mentions this in his Sunan as well. Imam Darimi has mentioned this as well in his Sunan. Imam Bazzar has mentioned this in the Muslim as well. Very famous narration, everybody has heard. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam makes the alarm. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam makes the announcement. But who is willing to give charity in the way of Allah Almighty? Who is willing to donate charity in the way of Allah Almighty? At that time, Rawi is Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Narrator is Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala. When Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam made this announcement, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he had his wealth with him at that time. And what did he do? He took all of his wealth. All of his wealth. Imagine that for a second. Taking all of your wealth. And he split it into two. Half. Half for his family, half for Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said to himself that today I'm going to outdo Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. This was that very same Umar that his deeds were equivalent to the stars in the skies. Sayyidina Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, she one day was standing with Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Pitch, black night. And the stars were out. And she said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, is there anyone whose deeds are equivalent to the stars in the skies? At that point, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Umar's deeds are equivalent to the stars in the skies. Sayyidina Aisha heard the answer, but she was slightly disappointed. And she said, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, what about my father? What about Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu? Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, regarding Abu Bakr's deeds, if you were to place all of the deeds of humanity on one side of the sky, and you were to place the deeds and the a'mal of Abu Bakr on the other side of the scale, then he goes, I take a qasam by Allah Almighty, the deeds of Abu Bakr will be heavier than the deeds and a'mal of the whole of humanity. Then Umar's deeds are equivalent to the stars in the skies. Abu Bakr's, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, his deeds are greater than the deeds of the whole of humanity put together. Afdalul Bashar ba'dal anbiya. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala, his deeds, his a'mal. Today Umar is saying that I'm going to outdo Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Today I'm going to win this competition, healthy competition between the Sahaba. So he goes, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habibullah, I give you half of my wealth. That's a good amount of your safe bet, you would say. Half of your wealth. Half. At that point, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq heard the announcement. What did he do? He went to his house. And he took everything that was in his house. Pots, hands, wealth, everything. Gathered it. And he brought it to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Ma abqaita li ahlika. That Ya Abu Bakr, what is it that you have left for your family? What is it that you have left for your family? And Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he gave so much in the way of Allah Almighty on this occasion that he even took the buttons on his shirt and he gave them in the way of Allah. Even the buttons on his shirt. And he took thorns and replaced these buttons. What is it? Abqaita li ahlika? Or ma abqaita li ahlika? What is it that you left for your family, Abu Bakr? At that point, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq said, أَبْقَيْتُ أَلَهُمُ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولُهُ. That I have left Allah and His Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for my people. Everybody's heard this riwayat. This riwayat ends here. There's one jumlah which I'm going to mention right up here. This riwayat ends here. Abdul Rahman as-Sulami,
or Ibn Asakir radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, they continue this narration.
Some of you may have heard this, some of you are hearing this for the first time. This incident took place. Abu Bakr has taken all of his wealth, pot, pans, dirham, dinar, even the buttons on his shirt, given it in the way of Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are sitting in Masjid Nabi Sharif. Ruhul Amin Sayyidina Jibreel comes. Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes. And Sayyidina Jibreel is wearing the same clothing that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was wearing. Same clothing that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was wearing. And they have the same buttons that Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. In place of the button, they have the thorn that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq had as well. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Jibreel, why is it that you're wearing this? At that point, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam said, Ya Rasulallah, Ya Habibullah, Allah Almighty has ordered me to wear this today, and He has ordered all of the malaika to wear this as well today. But Allah Almighty has sent me with a question, that Hal anta an rabbika raati? This question is for Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. That Ya Rasulallah, Ya Habibullah, ask Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, that is he content with Allah Almighty? Hal anta an rabbika radi? That is Abu Bakr Siddiq razi with Allah Almighty? Khuda khud bande se pooche, bata teri raza kya? Allah Almighty is asking you and me, we try all our life to please Allah. We don't know whether our namaz is accepted, whether our zikr is accepted, whether this gathering is accepted. But such people have reached such a level, and Abu Bakr Siddiq reached such a level, that Allah Almighty is asking him, that Abu Bakr, are you happy with me? Abu Bakr, are you happy with me? Abu Bakr, are you content with me? At that point, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam calls Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq. And Ya Abu Bakr, Allah Almighty is asking the question, that Hal anta an rabbika radin? That are you content with Allah Almighty? When you've given everything that you have in the way of Allah, and now Allah is asking, are you content with Him? At that point, Abu Bakr makes the jumla. And the ulama mentioned this is the first jumla at the tasawwuf in the deen and in the majlis of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq says, Ana an Rabbi radin, Ana an Rabbi radin, Ana an Rabbi radin. That indeed I am content with Allah, indeed I am content with Allah, indeed I am content with Allah. And as they were saying this, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq took his right index finger and they went like this. Ana an Rabbi radin, Ana an Rabbi radin, Ana an Rabbi radin. That was the first jumla of the tasawwuf in the majlis of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the ulama mentioned that this movement is the first wajd in the majlis of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq is content with Allah Almighty. And when Abu Bakr is content with Allah, Allah is content with Abu Bakr, then there is no doubt and no problem to accept that the greatest human being after the prophets is Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq. At that point, Sayyidina Umar, he goes, Wallahi la asbikuhu ila shay'in abada. He goes, I take a qasam by Allah Almighty, I will never ever be able to outdo Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq. Who is saying this? Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala. That same Farooq, the shaitan, would have given a walk in his path. That Farooq was differentiating between truthfulness and falsehood. He goes, today I've realized that I can't do it. Outdo Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq. The last point. Said Imam Sahib, you said that 6 minutes ago. Inshallah. Last point. Just that love between Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam left this dunya on the 12th of Rabiul Awwal at the age of 63. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq became Khalifatul Rasul. He became the leader of the Muslims, Amir al-Mu'mineen, the leader of the Muslims. For 2 years and 7 months, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq ruled over the Muslims. And they said that the cause of the passing away of Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq was because that he was departed from the love of Rasulullah. He was disconnected from Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He was distant from Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. His body, his soul, everything that he had depended, his survival depended upon Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Allahu Akbar.
They know that the reason and the cause of his passing away was because of his distance from Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And then eventually when he did pass away, two great things were achieved from the many things in his caliphate. Number one was the stance against Musaylimah al-Kazzab, the liar, the one who claimed to be a false prophet. And Sayyidina Khalid bin Walid was sent, Battle of Yamama. And then the second thing was that the Quran was gathered into one mushaf. These things were prominent and prevalent in the caliphate of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala. Eventually the time came, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is about to leave the dunya. And they said to Sayyidina Aisha Siddiqa, that, oh my daughter, go ask Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam for permission. Ask Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's permission, that is Abu Bakr allowed to be buried next to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Is Abu Bakr allowed to be buried next to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? And that voice comes from inside the Rawdah Sharif, that Abu Bakr is given permission to be buried next to him. They leave this dunya 8 days before the end of the month of Jamadul Ula. And they are aged 63 years old. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is 63, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu is 63 as well. No way have we done justice to them. Just a few things. Things that you maybe already knew anyway. Hopefully refreshed your memories. Allah Almighty give us the tawfiq to act upon what we have heard. Allah Almighty give us the tawfiq of the true love that Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq had. True love. Inshallah Azza wa Jal. In the azan now for Salatul Isha. After which there will be the Jama'at. I'm going to make an offer. But I say I'm not much of a speaker. I prefer sitting and doing zikr, loud zikr. I'm going to make an offer. Master Nair Tizami Adri? Haji Sahib, Ijazat Abad. Isha Tuba, Mukhtazar Zikr Jah. Those of you who want to stay can stay. Those that don't want to stay, you can go. Loud zikr inshallah straight after Salatul Isha. I need it myself. And if you stay, inshallah you will enjoy. This is the real reason to revive our hearts, to awaken our souls. So we'll do zikr inshallah for a short while. Ijazat? Jazakum Allah khair. Wa ahsanul jazal. Once again the brothers are inviting me. May Allah Almighty reward the efforts, accept the efforts. Inshallah Azza wa Jal. Please bear that point in mind. Let's not give people titles, especially when those people are not worthy of their titles. Jazakumullah khair. Wa ma'alaykum.